Sounds like the microphone is on, so good morning, everyone. It is a real pleasure to be here in Ljubljana talking to such a distinguished group of experts, practitioners, social movements, trade unionists, social workers. Thank you very much for inviting me. I understand that the way that this works is I will say something and then it will be translated into Slovenian.
Kot vidite, mikrofon deluje, tehnika deluje. Torej, najprej bi vas prav lepo pozdravil. Sem resnično vesel, da sem lahko tukaj v Ljubljani in da bom smel govoriti pred takšno izbrano publiko strokovnjakov, prav sindikalistov, socialnih delavcev in drugih. Torej, najlepša hvala. Čeprav razumem, se bo moj govor tolmačil v slovenski jezik, tako bom najprej sam povedal nekaj deset na to, ko me boste uspe tolmačili.
So I have spent the last 8 years spending a lot of time traveling around Western Europe, mostly Germany and the UK, but also Denmark, France. I've been talking to people who are involved in social services, especially for the unemployed. And what I've mainly worked is, what I've mainly learned is what does not work. And I've also learned quite a lot about what causes problems. So that is the main thing I'm going to be talking about, is dysfunction.
Zadnjih 8 let sem veliko potoval po Evropi, torej po vzhodnji Evropi, bil sem v Veliki Britaniji, Nemčiji, pa tudi na Danskem in v Franciji. In tam sem govoril z socialnimi delavci, oziroma z osebami, ki delajo na področju sociala, predvsem tistimi, ki delajo z brezposelnimi. In skozi te pogovore sem se naučil, kaj ne deluje in tudi predvsem to, kaj povzroča težave. In potem bom danes tudi govoril torej o nedelovanju tega sistema.
So, towards the end, I will say a few things about what kinds of policies might be less destructive to vulnerable, socially excluded people. And I hope also with this talk to help stimulate a discussion about how to fight particularly destructive neoliberal policies. And the kind of policy that I'm going to be talking about is this one. Punitive active labor market policies.
Ob koncu mojega predavanja bom namenil nekaj časa tudi politikam, predvsem tistim manj uničujočim politikam, ki manj negativno vplivajo na njih, na ranljive skupine in na marginalizirane skupine. Prav tako pa bi vas rad stimuliral k razpravi in o tem, da se pogovarjamo o teh uničujočih neoliberalnih politikah, predvsem pa se bom usmeril na tole kaznovalno politiko trga dela.
The idea of these is that you recalibrate the labor market by changing welfare state. The welfare state becomes an important tool for labor market policy. So you cut back welfare entitlements in a way that is supposed to increase participation in the labor market. This, in turn, is supposed to combat social exclusion and poverty.
Govorim bom o spremembah na trgu dela in o spremembah socialne države. Torej, govori se, da s tem, ko zmanjšujemo pravice in tudi potem podporo, ki jo dobivajo te osebe, s tem povečujemo njihovo participacijo na trgu dela in s tem se borimo proti socialni izključenosti.
So there is a recipe promoted by mainstream policy discourse and international institutions such as the OECD and the European Commission that promote this policy consensus. And the policy recipe is the following. The first thing is that you demand that jobless people who are receiving welfare benefits look for work and accept whatever job they are offered.
Torej obstajajo glavni politični tokovi, ki se jih držijo, na primer OECD in tudi druge inštitucije. In ta politika podaja recept, ki zahteva, da ljudje sprejmejo kakršnokoli delo, če želijo obdržati socialno pomoč.
You provide various services to support them, training services, advice services, job placement services. You demand that they participate in those services, and if they don't comply with their requirements to participate in these services and look for jobs and accept whatever jobs are offered, then you take away their benefits.
Inštitucije jim ponujajo najrazličnejše storitve, kot na primer usposabljanje, svetovanje, napotitve na delovna mesta, od njih pa zahtevajo, da v tem procesu sodelujejo. In če ne sodelujejo, če ne iščejo službe in če ne sprejmejo službe, ki jim je ponujena, se jim te pravice vzamejo.
Then you extend this regime beyond people who are traditionally treated as job seekers to the so-called inactive, more vulnerable people, such as disabled people and lone parents, because many people who work in these services think this is a bad idea, then you use various performance management techniques to deal with frontline workers, especially social workers, who do not want to implement these kinds of policies, and you do all of this without spending too much money.
In potem se ta režim razširi še na osebe, ki niso tradicionalni iskalci zaposlitve, to so neaktivne osebe in pa bolj ranljive osebe, kot na primer invalidi in pa samohranilci. Seveda pa obstajajo ljudje, ki se s tem ne strinjajo in zato se uvaja vodenje učinkovitosti teh reform, ki pa se potem izvajajo nad delavci oziroma uslužbenci, ki delajo s strankami, to so predvsem socialni delavci.
So, in European policy discourse, there is discussion of flexicurity, but it's quite obvious that what really results from this is more flexicurity, more flexibility, and less security. In the UK right now, there is a very good example of this. Disabled people have been reclassified as job seekers. We know from talking to frontline workers who are trying to help them find jobs that there are many terminally ill unemployed people who are classified as job seekers. We now know how many people actually die after they are declared fit for work. In the UK, every month, 90 people die within 2 weeks of being declared fit for work.
In seveda je potrebno za vse te ukrepe uporabiti čim manj denarja. V Evropi delimo tako imenovani prožni varnosti, ampak prožna varnost pravzaprav pomeni več fleksibilnosti in manj varnosti. Tako vam lahko dam primer. V Veliki Britaniji se kot iskalci zaposlitve klasificira ponovem tudi invalidne osebe in mnogi delavci oziroma službenci, ki delajo s strankami, vedo, da je mnogo teh tudi na smrt bolnih, torej ti so potem klasificirani kot iskalci zaposlitve. In ve se tudi, da jih mnogo od teh umre, v Veliki Britaniji jih umre celo 90 takšnih oseb na mesec, ki se jih je klasificiralo kot osebe, ki so sposobne za delo.
So, the intention behind this is plausible enough. The consequences of it are sometimes devastating to vulnerable people. So what overall is gained by this policy? The answer is that actually we do not really know.
Namen je nekoliko jasen, posledice predvsem za ranljive skupine ljudi pa so obupne. Kaj s tem pridobimo? Odgovor je, da tega ne vemo.
This is a strange thing that we don't know this, because there have been 40 years of evaluation studies, huge amounts of money spent trying to determine what kinds of schemes under which conditions actually lead to people getting jobs. And what we know is just that the success of a scheme in terms of the policy objectives depends on a lot of factors. What outcome you're measuring, whether it's income or the job, whether someone has a job, what kind of client they are, how close they are to the labor market or distant, the macroeconomic context, whether there's a lot of hiring or not much hiring, and the kind of service. So designing these services to meet the stated objective is really more of an art, I would say, than a science.
Nekoliko čudna stvar je, da že 40 let potekajo raziskave, presoje, ki so stale kar nekaj denarja na temo, kateri sistem je najboljši za vključevanje brezposelnih v trg dela. Vemo, da je tukaj prisotnih več različnih vplivov, kaj lahko ocenjujemo oziroma presojamo. Da prvo je lahko to izid, ali je oseba dobila delovno mesto, ali se je zaposlila. Kot drug kriterij lahko upoštevamo, kako blizu je že bila trgu dela. Kot tretjo je ekonomski kontekst in tako dalje. Torej lahko bi rekli, da je ekonomijo te sistemo in njihovo vrednotenje že prava umetnost.
I've pulled out two quotes from studies, from papers that try to evaluate the evaluation studies to show in general what works. These are by researchers who think that these kinds of measures are really a good thing and policymakers should really try to make them work. However, what they say is that because they're intellectually honest, they say when there is an effect observed, it is usually quite small, and often there's no effect or a perverse or negative effect. This is a non-finding, I would say, that is a finding. It shows that these schemes generally don't work.
In sicer ta dva raziskovalca pravita, da so ti ukrepi v bistvu v redu, ker pa sta intelektualno poštena, pa sta povedala tudi, da sicer je nek manjši učinek, ampak na dolgi rok pa ni. Torej, lahko bi rekli, da to ne kaže na noben rezultat, ampak tudi to je rezultat.
One reason for this is a problematic relationship between the clients who are supposed to be placed in jobs and their prospective employers. Active labor market schemes cannot solve this problem by themselves, and particularly punitive schemes probably exacerbate this problem.
Ena težava je v odnosu med iskalcem zaposlitve in med delodajalcem in aktivne politike zaposlovanja tega problema ne morejo rešiti same po sebi, pa tudi kaznovalni programi niso rešitev.
There are two main reasons why they may exacerbate employers' willingness to discriminate against unemployed people that I know of. One of them is that they create stigma by flagging up problems that clients may have on their jobs, such as the fact that they are lone parents and therefore have complex childcare needs, or they are addicted to drugs and that can make them unreliable. There's a kind of handicapology that the welfare state creates. The second reason is that they may create forms of exploitative labor in which people have to work for their benefits, claimants protest against it, and employers do not want to be targeted by social movements protesting the exploitation of vulnerable people.
Obstajata dva razloga, zakaj so takšni ukrepi diskriminatorni. Po eni strani je tukaj težava z delodajalci. Zagotovo si ne želijo zaposliti strank, kot so na primer starši samohranilci, ki morajo še ob tem, da delajo skrbeti za svoje otroke, prav tako ne želijo zaposlovati odvisnikov, ki veljajo kot nezanesljivi. In tako na tem področju socialna država ustvari nekakšen handicap. Po drugi strani pa delodajalci ne želijo zaposlovati tako imenovane skupine ljudi, ki se na nek način izkorišča, saj preko tega, da delajo, dobijo socialno podporo. In tako se delodajalci bojijo protestov razno raznih družbenih gibanj.
So after 4 decades of attempting to get employers interested in active labor market policies, policymakers have still not figured out how to do that. In addition, there are perverse consequences, which are just as poorly understood as the sensible intended consequences.
Po 40 letih ustvarjene aktivne politike za zaposlovanje, ki bi jo lahko ponudili delodajalcem, oblikovalci politik še vedno ne vedo, kako jih oblikovati. Ob tem pa se pojavljajo tudi razno razni neželeni učinki, ki jih še ne razumemo.
A social democrat from Italy, who's involved in the current welfare reforms, told me, what we are doing is weakening the structural power of unions. Common sense dictates that if you take people outside of the labor market and turn them into competitors in the labor market, this will weaken the bargaining power of workers. There is therefore a potential relationship between active labor market policies and precarity.
Socialni demokrat iz Italije, ki dela na reformi trga dela, mi je povedal, da s tem tudi s takšnimi reformami na nek način šibimo sam trg dela. Torej, če vzameš nekoga, ki je daleč stran od trga dela in ga mu želiš poiskati zaposlitev, s tem ustvarjaš konkurenco in šibiš moč pogajalsko moč delavcev. In tako imamo na nek način se ustvarja odnos, da aktivna politika zaposlovanja dejansko ustvarja prekernost.
I have pulled out quotes from Karl Marx and from the OECD. Karl Marx says that when the laws of supply and demand do not facilitate employers pushing down workers' wages, then the state intervenes to make sure that workers' wages get pushed down. The OECD says that states should intervene to push workers' wages down using active labor market schemes and tight conditions attached to benefits. Marx and the OECD agree that this happens, the state intervenes to ensure that job quality does not increase too much.
Tukaj sem izbral citat Marksa in OECD-ja, ki pravi, da če se delavec oziroma če se upiramo svetemu zakonu povpraševanja in ponudbe, na to skušamo svoja neustrezna dejanja preverjati s prisilo in se država začne vmešavati. Prav tako OECD pravi, da se država vmešava in posega v aktivno politiko zaposlovanja. In Marks in OECD se oba strinjata, da država posega v to politiko, zato da bi ohranila kakovost dela, oziroma da se kakovost dela ne bi povečala.
So why is it so difficult to understand the real effects of these schemes? One problem that I'm currently in the process of writing a book about is that there is a real gap between policy and what happens in workplaces where workers are trying to assist job seekers. This gap has three reasons. One is that claimants may not comply with what the policy says. A second reason is that social workers may disagree with the policy and not comply with it. A third one is that management may introduce all kinds of performance management processes that are counterproductive. And there's a fourth one as well, apologies. The work may be privatized, which creates additional complexity and distance between policy and the world of the workplace in which it is implemented.
Загадката е тоа што е разумете го цвите. Првата жалба е и тем се даде да пишам книга, ја раскол мед мед политика и мед укрепи и мед пракса, тоа е како се извоја у пракси. Имамо три, одвирома четири разлоги за таа раскол. Први е da morda iskalci zaposlitve ne upoštevajo teh pravil, določil. Drugi je, da se tudi socialni delavci, svetovalci lahko temu oprejo. In tretji, da vodstvo uvaja nadzorovanje, spremljanje kakovosti, kar lahko tudi deluje kontraproduktivno. Četrti razlog pa je tudi privatizacija dela, ki je dodatno pripomore k temu razvoju.
The use of market mechanisms and performance management is the policy recipe for solving the problems of active labor market policies. However, when you spend time talking to the people involved in this system, you realize that this solution just creates more problems. We've identified in this book five different dilemmas.
Ti mehanizmi nadzorovanja in pa ta prisila bi naj rešila, bi naj bila rešitev za brezposelnost, ampak kot vidimo, ko se pogovarjamo z ljudmi, to ustvarja le še več problemov in o tem pišem tudi v knjigi.
The first has to do with bureaucracy and transaction costs. So there is this idea out there that you can reduce your costs if you introduce markets in a fair, transparent, and open way. This does not work this way.
Prva težava, ki se tukaj pojavi, je birokracija in pa drage tranzicije. Zamisel je, da porabimo manj denarja, če vse oblikujemo pošteno, odprto in transparentno, ampak žal to tako ne deluje.
So there are two reasons why this is the case. One of them is that if you have on the one hand, you have to have a competition that is open and free and fair and transparent. Reason for this is not only because this is the ideology of public sector management. There are also all kinds of rules emanating from the European Commission that require these principles, and they're embedded in European procurement law. The principle of European procurement law that motivates it is that there should be a single European market for services, including social services.
На одній стороні потребуємо відкриту конференцію, яка поштена, яка транспарентна, це ідеологія, яка стоїть за реальним сектором, і то захтіває тут Європейська унія на подручу явного нарочення, наприклад, B&I і мері Елфкупен, ремонтний торг, який є транспарентен тут за подручу сторітелі.
In order to have this kind of market, one where any provider can participate, where the tenders are widely advertised, where every aspect of the process can be justified, you have to have a lot of bureaucracy. You have to document everything. There are many steps in this process. There have to be legal experts involved. And in short, it's expensive and bureaucratic to have a market that corresponds to the legal principles of fairness in contracting. In the United Kingdom, the government has evaded this responsibility somewhat by outsourcing the procurement function, at least in employment services, to private companies. So it's a private sector bureaucracy in Britain that is responsible for managing purchasing, but is not held to this standard. However, in Germany, this function is done in-house. If there are any policymakers here who would like to learn about how to organize a free and transparent and quite bureaucratic process for price-based contracting, you should go to Germany because they have an amazingly competent bureaucracy organizing its market for labor market services. It's big and expensive, but they're quite competent and confident, and they can tell you how they are able to justify every single little thing that they do, despite many, many objections from people in the system.
У Великій Британії є влада, ті запосвітлені сторітви, якби аутсорсила, якби завеліла за сильному секторю, який сідає управля тим подручям, якби вона вирішує стандартом. У Німчині є то другаче, є то, що змірає у пристойності держави, і це тут як доме власті, де живі навчити, як транспарентно і поштено, і розумно публікувати такшні політики. Є найбільше, так, де це у Німчі, там є огромна бюрократія, яка себе дав велико стане, ампак все знаю натачно розложити за хай сторіння.
So much for transaction costs. Now let's talk about value for money. This is the British term for squeezing prices while saying that the services that you get are good. Unfortunately, it doesn't work that way.
Prejdimo od transakcije k tako imenovani value for money, torej vrednosti, ki jo dobite za vaš denar. Z drugimi besedami lahko rečemo, da to pomeni, da znižujemo stroške, storitve pa so še zmeraj dobre, seveda pa temu ni tako.
There are two reasons for this, at least, that I know of. The first one is that if you squeeze prices, if you push prices down using competition, you have to turn the services into a commodity, In order to turn services into a commodity, you have to say in an extremely detailed fashion what they will be before they are delivered. If you do that, it's impossible for providers to innovate, to have new services in response to changing conditions. If providers cannot innovate, the services are not going to respond to the conditions of the changing social and labor market conditions, and that is a big problem for quality for these kinds of services.
Za to pa obstajata dva razloga, oziroma vse jaz poznam dva razloga. Prvi je, da če znižujete stroške, to pomeni, da se boste morali obrniti na konkurenco in storitve bodo morale postati blago. Kaj pa to točno pomeni? Če so storitve blago, jih je treba najprej točno definirati, da izvajalci vedo, kaj morajo početi. Ko pa vedo, kaj morajo početi, to pomeni, da niso inovativni in da se ne morejo odzivati na spremembe. Niso inovativni in tako, ko pride do sprememb na trgu dela, ne ustvarjajo novih drugačnih inovativnih storitev in to seveda vpliva na kakovost.
A second reason why you can't have good services for low prices is the personnel consequences of low prices. If there are fewer resources going into an organization than before, that means that there will be fewer workers, or lower skilled workers, or the skills that those workers have are going to be devalued. All of those things undermine the quality of services.
Drugi razlog, ki ga jaz poznam, zakaj nizka cena storitev oziroma zniževanje stroškov ni dobro, pa je vpliv, ki ga ima to na osebje. Manj virov, finančnih virov v organizaciji pomeni manjšo, slabšo izobrazbo zaposlenih, tudi manj zaposlenih in s tem tudi razvrednotimo vrednost teh zaposlenih in s tem dejansko spodkopavamo vrednost teh storitev.
So much for the promise that you can have good service for low prices. Now let's talk about what happens if you try to only pay for those services that lead to the outcome you want. Here you come into another dilemma, which has to do with creaming and parking effects. If you pay by results, this means that there will be unequal access to services. There will be systematic incentives for providers to focus their attentions and staff time on people who are close to the labor market, and they will spend less money or as little money as they can on people who are distant from the labor market.
Toliko torej o obljubi, da zniževanje stroškov prinaša rezultate. Sedaj pa si še poglejmo drugo področje, torej, da plačujemo za storitve samo zato, da pridemo do rezultatov. Tukaj gre za selektiven pristop, za to, da plačujemo za to, da dobimo rezultate in to pomeni, da dostop do storitev ne bo enak za vse. Izvajalci storitev bodo pri tem postopali sistematično, zaposleni bodo porabljali svoj čas za tiste, ki so bližje trgu dela, manj denarja pa se bo porabilo za ljudi, ki niso tako blizu trgu dela.
In the United Kingdom, there are large firms who run the main schemes that are supposed to be helping people find jobs that have very sophisticated systems in place to make sure that creaming and parking does take place. The way that they do this is IT systems in which they can monitor everything that members of staff do, as well as the activities of clients. Targets, so staff are rewarded for finding jobs for people and punished for failing to find jobs for people. And then a clear sense of what the minimum service is that they are allowed to do, this means that caseloads for workers working with the most vulnerable are actually much bigger than those working with less vulnerable people who can find jobs. We've seen caseloads of up to 300 for people dealing with the tough clients.
V Veliki Britaniji imamo nekaj glavnih podjetij, ki zagotavljajo storitve na področju iskanja zaposlitve. In izdelali so dovršen sistem, ki je dejansko zelo vse selektiven. Pri tem se poslužujejo IT sistemom, s katerim nadzorujejo zaposlene in preverjajo aktivnost svojih klientov. Potem imajo določene cilje, s katerimi in če ti cilji niso doseženi, zaposlene kaznujejo ali pa jih nagrajujejo, če so cilji doseženi. Obstaja pa tudi minimalno določena količina storitev, to je morda le klic ali e-mail sporočilo na mesec. In tako opažamo, da je število strank zaposlenih iz ranljivih skupin veliko večji v primerjavi s tisto skupino, ki je bliže trgu dela. To pomeni, da imajo zaposleni približno 300 težje zaposljivih stran.
So, you can't pay for only the results you want while having a service that serves everyone. A fourth dilemma has to do with compulsion and consumer choice. So, one part of the ideology says that we want users of public services who have a choice and can use the provider that they think is the best. Another side of it says that these clients do not have good judgment, and therefore we should make sure that they do what we, policymakers and those charged with implementing the policies, that they do what we want.
Torej, kot vidite, ne moremo zgolj gledati na to, da dobimo rezultate, če za njih plačamo, če želimo imeti storitve, ki bodo enake za vse. Pa se posvetimo še četrti dilemi, torej izbira ali prisila. Po eni strani pravimo, da morajo imeti uporabniki izbiro, morajo imeti možnost, da sami izberejo najboljšega ponudnika, po drugi strani pa nekateri pravijo, da uporabniki ne znajo sami presojati in zato imamo oblikovalce politik in izvajalce teh politik, ki pravijo, da bodo sami tem strankam te dali izbiro.
In Germany, Denmark and the UK, the vast majority of the schemes that we have observed are compulsory. That means that this idea that clients of the welfare state should be entrepreneurs of the self and self-reliant and going out and finding jobs for themselves, that is really absent when it comes to choosing which services they're going to use. There is, however, one exception, and that is the German voucher scheme.
Tako v Nemčiji, na Danskem in v Veliki Britaniji opažamo, da je velika večina programov, ki so na voljo, obveznih. Po eni strani govorimo, da stranke morajo biti podjetne, da morajo biti samozadostne, da morajo znati same poiskati stranko. Te izbire pa nimajo, ko pride do tega, katero storitev si želijo izbrati. Sicer pa v Nemčiji obstaja izjema in to je sistem voucherja.
The German voucher scheme formally prohibits workers in the public employment service from referring clients to providers, external providers. The clients are supposed to act as consumers and take their vouchers to a company that will give them a training service or will help place them in a job. In reality, the evaluation evidence shows that these vouchers are hardly used except when someone in the public employment service is helping the client and referring them to a provider. So it's an exception that proves the rule, because customer choice here is simply not working in the face of overwhelming compulsion, which is making it difficult for clients to choose services.
Torej, ta nemški sistem voucherja prepoveduje službencev zavoda za zaposlovanje ali drugih zaposlitvenih agencij, da brezposelnim povedo oziroma jih napotijo na neko storitev, na neko izobraževanje. Stranka je s tem voucherjem kot nek navaden konzument in lahko sama izbira, katerega ponudnika želi obiskati. Ampak realnost je žal taka, da to ne deluje. Brezposelni teh voucherjev ne uporabljajo, oziroma jih bolj na pobudo svetovalcev za zaposlitev. To je izjema, ki potrjuje pravilo, da če je storitev preveč, se prav tako težko odločiti in ni učinka.
The final dilemma that I'd like to talk about is internal versus external capacity. If you privatize services, you destroy public sector capacity, usually, and sometimes that is even intended by policymakers. But the opposite sometimes happens. Work that is done by contractors is insourced. We've seen that both in Germany and in Denmark. This creates another dilemma, though. Because this destroys capacity that is outside of the public sector, which sometimes is valued. If that is in the voluntary sector, if that's nonprofit work carried out by activist social workers, for example, that can be a significant loss in terms of the capacity of the system to serve the most vulnerable clients.
Imamo pa še eno dilemo, to je notranja oziroma zunanja kapaciteta. Vse te storitve privatiziramo, izobraževanja in tako dalje, potem nekako onemogočimo javnemu sektorju, da bo te storitve izvajal tudi v prihodnosti. V Nemčiji in na Danskem smo to videli, da lahko pride tudi do negativnih posledic v zunanji kapaciteti, torej to pomeni, ko se moč vzame aktivistom na socialnem področju, torej prostovoljskim organizacijam in tako dalje.
Sorry about that. That was very technical at times and quite complicated in any case. The bottom line of this is that if you marketize these services, you don't necessarily solve any problems, but you definitely create new problems. I'm going to talk about a worse case, which is where I've been working, the UK.
Čujem se za nekoliko bolj tehnično izrazoslovje, ki sem ga uporabil. V bistvu vsega, kar sem želil povedati, je, da marketizacija ni rešitev, ampak da vodi do še večjih težav. In sedaj želim predstaviti primer, ki se je zgodil v Veliki Britaniji.
I don't really have time to say everything that is important about the work program, but let me stress just a small number of points. The first one is that it has a very strong class dimension. So the state has decided to relinquish control under the so-called black box contracting approach. They've decided to empower large private firms to design, not only deliver services, but also to design them. And they've allowed these large private firms to profit and to distribute these profits to shareholders. This is supposed to be the incentive for creating innovative services. I say this is a strong, this has a strong class dimension, not only because there are profiteers in a very literal sense, but also because this is highly punitive for the clients who are subject to sanctioning when they're in these firms.
Zdaj ne bo imel časa, da gremo v podrobnosti, ampak bi želela podariti le nekaj točk. Prva je razredna dimenzija. Torej, vemo, da se oddajanje dela zunanjim izvajalcem izvaja na kakšni črni skrinjici. Torej, imamo velika zasebna podjetja, ki so pristojna ne le za izvajanje storitev, ampak tudi za njihovo oblikovanje. Obenem pa od tega imajo od tega še dobiček, ki se na to prerazporedi med delničarji. In to je ena od spodbud za ustvarjanje teh inovativnih pristopov in storitev. Tukaj lahko vidimo zelo velike razredne dimenzije. Torej, po eni strani imamo te dobičkarje, lahko jih imenujemo dobičkarji, po drugi strani pa kaznujemo stranke, ki koristijo storitve teh podjetij.
How they are evaluated by policymakers is quite interesting. On the one hand, they perform badly because they do not provide large numbers of job outcomes to vulnerable clients. They do less badly when it comes to clients close to the labor market. This is because of so-called premium parking effects. On the other hand, it's very inexpensive. The reason why it's inexpensive is that if companies do not find jobs for people, the state does not have to pay them. So the government says, well, they don't find jobs for the most vulnerable people very well, but at least they save us money, so they're good for something.
Tako pa oblikovalci politik te izvajalce storitev ocenjujejo. Po eni strani lahko rečemo, da pri zagotavljanju dela za bolj ranljive skupine niso učinkoviti. Po drugi strani pa se govori, da spet niso tako slabi, saj zagotovijo delo vsaj za tiste, ki so bliže trgu dela. In tukaj se ponovno pojavlja ta selektivni pristop. Oblikovalci politik pa pravijo tudi, da so zunanji ponudniki storitev, da niso dragi, saj če ne zagotovijo dela za brezposelne, jih država ne rabi plačati. In tako vlada pravi, da sicer ne poiščejo dela za ranljive skupine, ampak na zaradi tega vsaj nastane veliko in tudi to šteje.
If you do not want to go down the path of Britain and Germany and other countries that impose punitive active labor market policies leading to precarity both of the clients and of the workforce, you may want to look at so-called insertion in France. So I promised you that I would not just tell you what is bad, but I would also perhaps I would give you some idea about what might be less problematic in the world of active labor market policies. So now I'm going to very quickly deliver that promise.
Okay. Zagotovo si ne želite iti po poti Velike Britanije, Nemčije in drugih držav, ki so uvedle kaznovalno aktivno politiko zaposlovanja in s tem povzročajo še večjo prekarnost med tako strankami kot tudi med uslužbenci. Torej, če si tega ne želite, predlagam, da si sedaj ogledamo to gibanje v Franciji, dal vam bo nekaj idej o tem, kako oblikovati bolj primerne aktivne politike za poslovanje. Torej to bom naredil kar na hitro, ampak kljub temu bom izpolnil obljubo, ki sem jo dal na začetku.
One thing about this system is that there is a strong degree of control by networks of local nonprofit providers and local policymakers, bureaucrats and politicians. And this despite the fact that it's mainly funded by the European Social Fund. So if you want to know, maybe you can get some ideas about how to deal with the European Social Fund, if you go to the place in France that we have been to, namely Saint-Saint-Denis, in the suburbs of Paris, which I believe has roughly the same population as Slovenia.
Želim vam predstaviti sistem, v katerem imajo še vedno velik del kontrole neprofitni izvajalci storitev, pa tudi lokalni birokrati in oblikovalci politik. Kljub temu, da se te storitve financirajo s pomočjo Evropskega socialnega sklada. Torej želim vam pokazati, kako uporabiti Evropski socialni sklad. To pa vam bom pokazal na primeru okraja Saint-Saint-Denis, torej enega od okrožji Pariza, ki je približno tako velik kot Slovenija, oziroma ima toliko prebivalcev kot Slovenija.
The policy behind this is really different from the policy of punitive active labor market policies, even though the purpose is to help outsiders find jobs. One difference is that they don't believe in compulsion, really. They think that that does not work. Also, the goal is different. The goal is not just any job. The goal is the kind of job that is non-precarious, and that is how they talk about it. They want jobs that are stable, and above all, when it comes to the policy objective, jobs that are eligible for social insurance contributions. So rather than kicking people out of the welfare state, actually, they're inserting people into this thing that includes both work and the insurance-funded part of the welfare state.
Pokazal vam bom politiko, ki je drugačna od kaznovalne aktivne politike zaposlovanja, čeprav kljub temu pomaga ljudem, da pride na trg dela. Sistem je drugačen, se pravi, da prisila ne deluje in da je cilj tega sistema, da oseba ne dobi kakršnega koli dela, ampak dela, ki ni prekarno. Želijo si, da bi osebe imele stabilno zaposlitev in pa tudi, da ostane upravičene do socialnega zavarovanja, torej, da obenem obdržijo zaposlitev, da so zaposlene, ampak da so še kljub temu upravičene do socialne podpore.
So French insertion is something else that if you're a policymaker here, I would highly recommend that you look at if you're looking for an alternative. If you're a worker, this is also interesting because the people we've spoken to who are working in the system are much less likely to be in precarious jobs than in the other countries we've looked at. It is they do, however, complain about one thing, which we see everywhere, which is that it's highly bureaucratic and a huge amount of time is spent filling in online forms. As far as I know, nobody has figured out how to prevent that. But okay, I'm running out of time. Let me just conclude.
Torej, če si želite pogledati takšno alternativo, je to zagotovo gibanje francoskih podjetij. In v tem sistemu so tudi delavci bolj zadovoljni, saj je veliko manj prekarnih zaposlitev, kot v primerjavi z drugimi državami, ki smo jih opazovali. Ostala pa je še ena težava, ki ni rešena. To je velik obseg birokracije in veliko časa, ki ga je potrebno za izpolnjevanje spletnih obrazcev, ampak to je ena od stvari, za katero še nismo našli rešitve. In ker mi zmanjkuje časa, bom počasi zaključil.
My advice is to be skeptical of international best practice, to ask tough questions about whether these policies work in their country of origin, to ask what are the perverse consequences that international institutions are not telling you about, to ask tough questions about whether they're even relevant to the Slovenian context, and finally, use your professional common sense, only accept policies that you believe make sense in Slovenia. That's all I have to say. Many thanks.
Dovolite mi, da zaključim. Bodite skeptični, ko vam omenjajo mednarodne primere dobrih praks. Vprašajte, če sploh delujejo v državi, v kateri se izvajajo, in se vprašajte tudi, kakšne neželene posledice lahko imajo. In vprašajte se, če bodo potem sploh delovale, ko se bodo prenesle v Slovenijo, in uporabljajte svojo strokovno zdravo pamet. In to bi bilo to. Hvala.